All right, so first thing we're going to do is the order survival. Imagine yourself in any kind of scary situation. You either want to, you know, naturally we go to our brainstem. We're not going to be using our frontal cortex. Instincts kick in, either fight, flight, or freeze. So how do you not panic? There's no such thing as not doing something. You have to replace it with something. And the opposite of panic is breathing. So I want you, if you're watching this, to do this with me. Put your hands on your belly. This is the first thing in a survival situation. Put your hands on your belly. Blow out all your air. And then suck in the air with your belly. And then push it out. This time when you suck in with your belly, make you extending your belly as if you're a woodwind instrument player. Stick it out as you're breathing in, and then your chest afterwards. One deep breath. And by the way, 10 deep breaths will warm you up if you're too cold. It's really amazing getting that oxygen all the way to all your cells in your body. All right, so that's the first thing to do in an emergency situation. Number two, the second thing you want to do in an emergency situation is shelter. And so that may mean if you're out in the street, you make sure that you're in a safe place. But if you're in a wilderness situation, that's the first thing you have to do. Most people think, oh, I want to start a fire so I feel better and warm up and stuff. But that usually wastes all their time and they end up freezing all night long because they can't get it going. Reason being is that you need air in 4 minutes. And you need to get warm or cooled back down. The correct kind of shelter within 4 hours is our guideline. This is the law of fours. A former PhD in our field of earth skills, I think, coined this. I think he called it the rule of threes, but I expanded the law of fours because you can go a little longer than 3 minutes or 3 days or 3 hours in these things. So the second thing you want to do is regulate your temperature. And that is done through shelter. And so one of these days, we're going to head out into the woods, and I'm going to show you our newly invented, about 5 years ago, by a actual kid at an event that I was volunteering at a Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation fundraiser. This kid invented what we've now called the Eagle's Nest. And I just heard Les Shroud today. He did kind of a really funny video about sheltering, seeing if he could survive in his house, all alone, isolating. Anyway, he mentioned that, as we know, you have to just make a bed. You need to make a bed to insulate yourself from the ground. That's pretty much all you can do on the first day of a survival situation, because usually you figure out in about half an hour before it gets dark, and that's about as much time as you have. So you just need a bed, and that's going to keep you alive. That's how people on the run throughout the ages survived. They didn't just lay down on the cold, hard ground and survive because they were tough. They survived because they knew they needed to gather together all the nasty stuff on the ground and good stuff at the top that they could find to create insulation between them and the ground. Because you know what insulates? Air. These windows right here are triple pane windows because we get a lot of sun coming in here. And there's a big window. And so the more air that's trapped, the more insulative it is. The glass doesn't insulate. It's the air between the glass panes that insulates. And so that's the same case in us sheltering. So we're going to head out and do that in a few days sometimes when we feel like going to do a shelter. Okay, so that is what you need to try to do within 4 hours is to shelter or regulate your temperature through shelter. So third thing you want to do in an emergency situation is, let's see, what can you can survive? You want to get air within 4 minutes. You want to get your temperature regulated within 4 hours. And within 4 days, you need to secure some kind of hydration. And so that, of course, depends on whether how hot it is, how dry it is, how cold it is. All sorts of things affect that average of a 4 day time period that you really need to get some good water to drink. And I think the skill for that and the skill for any of these shelter, water, and the next ones that come after that is tracking, wildlife tracking. And that's one of my favorite thing to do. And it, because if you can find it, you don't have to make it. Anyways, so water, it's great to be able to find, but really the fire that you need in this day and age in order to not drink water that's going to make you sick with Giardia, by the way, yesterday, I've been drinking, let me check it out here. I've been drinking this pure spring water that we collected yesterday, and of course I'll let you know within 10 days whether I get Giardia, but that is what you want to avoid. And when we were growing up, there wasn't a lot of Giardia, but now it's in almost every stream and waterway. So fire is the third skill in order to heat your water up and to kill anything in it that, such as Giardia or other amoebas that can... Let me just say, I've never been pregnant myself, but I would say, as a man, the greatest pain you can ever feel is what happens to you when you have Giardia or amoebic dysentery. I've had both. Giardia here in Washington State and amoebic dysentery in Ecuador. And it basically takes your guts and just twists them up like really bad every 60 seconds. And then you have about 30 seconds of, oh, please don't come back. Anyway, so you don't want that. You want to heat your water up. And tomorrow we're going to do fire right out there around the fire pit. And then and that's kind of our special bed blanket and pillow way of making fire in any conditions, the best way to do it. And then the next day, bow drill, fire by friction. I'm going to demonstrate how to do that. And then on the next day, we're going to show you how to get a fire back going without even breathing on it, without doing any work, once it all dies out. And, you know, everybody's sitting around the fire and start throwing things on and blowing and all that kind of thing. It's all a waste of time. And it also, in a survival situation, really dehydrates you and gets you too tired. And so I'm going to show you how to make it go back into a flame without you having to do anything. And then, so that's the three, and then we want to get to the fourth survival thing that you need to do. Again, number one, breathe to avoid panic. That's within 4 minutes you need that air. Within 4 hours, you want to shelter in order to regulate your temperature. Within 4 days, you want water in order to hydrate. And for that skill, for that you need the skill of fire and also knowing how to put something. That's why the last thing I'd ever take out, not take out, would be a metal water container. Matter of fact, I'll show you in a minute what we bring out. So that's so you can just heat up water whenever you want. And then finally, within 4 weeks, and I know you're going to have all sorts of health problems within those 4 weeks from not eating, but you can survive most situations unless you're really expending a lot of energy, such as in the really cold or something, is food. So that's your fourth need. And of course, for that, you need to be able to find wild edibles. And that usually takes walking around and traveling to find those. And cattails we're probably not going to do because I have a good video on the Wolf Camp website of cattails, how to harvest them right out here around the house and how to cook them. But that's the number one food that you need to know generally. And but you also need to be able to find other kinds of foods, hunt and fish if necessary. But of course, we're going to be coming back to our farm more later this spring. And now that it is spring, by the way, first day of spring here on the Pacific Coast was Thursday night, and I failed to mention that. By the way, hello everybody. good to see you too, Lori and Christy. How you doing, Christy? All right, so that is the order of survival. Now, I wanted to just show you, I'm going to flip the camera around, and I'm going to turn on my computer, and I'm going to show you a couple of other things that you need to know to avoid emergency situations. Hey, Kimmer, I'm right in the middle of the broadcast. Yeah, so... let's see, where do I click on this in order to turn it backwards? I actually can't even... Oh, there it is. ...is my computer and Kim's amazing backpack, because you need to have the 10 essentials with you. This is something that we always tell everybody for years and years to always have in the trunk of your car. But now more than ever, everybody's probably hyper aware that, you know, you need to be stocked up on food and water and the other 10 essentials. So those 10 essentials, I'm going to show you there. If you go to our blog on our website here, move it a little bit closer and bring it up here so people can see. Our blog's right over here. You can go to outdoor skills, choose your skills, and you could go to wilderness survival for the navigation and survival articles. There's quite a few of them, and of course the basic ones, the ones that I want to start with, are further back in history. And here's all our, going to be posting, of course, all these broadcasts to the website, so that's going to take up a lot of space at the beginning. So you want to go back near the beginning, you know, our top native plants. Here's the shelter article, or and a video on how to build shelter, although we may go out and do that again. How to use a compass, map and compass. The top 10 lists of natural navigation, loss proofing, all those sorts of things. Cat, here's our cattail video and article. Most important wild edibles. Here's the order of emergency survival. And so those are some things you want to click on in order to... But I'm going to go to our slideshow. And here's our risk management slideshow that we use for navigation. And here's the 10 essentials. These are updated by REI has a really good 10 essentials list, as well as the Mountaineers. Mountaineers has a really good description. So, Kimmer, do you have all these in your backpack?
I hope so. Gonna,
usually, always.
Did you tell them that?
Yeah, Kim just came in from gardening.
You want me to look?
Sure. Navigation. Do you have a compass there? Well, actually, mine's right there. Do you want to show them what we use? Oh, of course you do.
I have everything.
You have everything.
Probably.
Sun protection?
Yep. I've got sunglasses and sunscreen. Mm-hmm. Okay. My first aid kit.
All right. Compass and a map? Or,
I don't know. Yeah, but of course. We're at home.
Yeah. how about, what do you have for insulation?
For insulation, I have this pad. Oh. Pad right on the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Yep. And then this is just a day pack, so you don't have... Well, what other insulation did you bring? Do you have your...
I do. I have a...
SOL bag?
Yeah. Oh, I do. But that's great. That's not really insulation. That's shelter. But yeah. Anyway, yeah, it's a survive outdoors longer. Mm-hmm. SOL. Haha. It's just a bivy bag. So we find that if you have a little survival blanket, you can put it over you, but the wind blows it up and... it's really, really loud and obnoxious, but this is actually a bag that you can climb into, which is really great. And
it does
really
have
small.
Some reflective insulation, but mm-hmm. It doesn't have any like air insulation, and so that's why you really want to build that bivy bed underneath you, or have the, you know, a foam pad. And why is it that you, by the way, have a foam and not like an air mattress?
Because an air mattress you can puncture, for one. And that would be a big bummer. And then in case of lightning, it's something that you can fold up and then kind of squat down on to keep you separated from the ground.
Yeah,
excuse me, not lightning. Lightning.
All right, so that's insulation.
My fleece for insulation.
Oh, good.
As well.
Yeah, of course, clothes and things. Yeah. How about illumination? Do you have a headlamp?
I do. I have a headlamp that's really awesome, and it is the rechargeable battery. Oh, there's my compass. Yeah.
Don't want to burn your battery on your phone for a light, that's for sure.
No, you don't do that. I actually have a couple of lights. So this is the Petzl headlamp with the core, I think it's called the core battery. Mm-hmm. Anyway, yeah, you just plug it in. It's got a little USB charger. I'll open it up. It's actually really sweet. There you go. Yeah, it's the core battery.
And how about first aid?
Let's
move on to first aid.
First aid kit. Oh, yeah, I totally do. And that's my first aid kit. But one thing that's really important is it seems like people always get cut. I don't know if I'm in this or not.
Yeah, you're good.
If people always get cut and you don't want to dig into your first aid kit, although you should always keep your first aid kit on top so it's really easy to get to. But I always keep a little zippy with some gloves and some band-aids in it in case anybody gets a little injury that we just need a quick band-aid for. And of course, you know, the gloves, always, always, always have gloves. Really easy to get, because if it's wet and it's not yours, don't touch it.
And of course, in this time of coronavirus, you're going to have hand sanitizer,
yep.
If you can find it, or make your own.
I have some in my first aid kit.
Mm-hmm.
And
well
then that mask sitting down here.
Some disinfectant wipes, because say you want to go... I don't know, use an outdoor exercise area. Mm-hmm. You want to wipe that off before and after you use it nowadays, even outdoors where viruses dissipate in the sun and in the air. Okay, what else next? How about fire? What do you got for fire?
So a couple things for fire. I've actually got my camp stove with my titanium little cook set and spoon. And
do you carry that for even for a day trip?
Often. I do. Okay. I'm paranoid. Actually, I just love having gear.
Well,
I really
of course,
do.
This is for in the back of a person's car. Because what if like an earthquake happens right now? It's great when people are at home because you're stocked with food and water right now, I bet. But if you're out and the bridges collapse, you want to have all this stuff in your car.
Yes, and I also have my fire steel, and I've got some cotton balls and some jute just to have some extra tinder with me.
Monday, I'm going to show you how to use this fire steel how to... And also, Kim, I was wondering if tomorrow, the next day, you can show, maybe tomorrow, how to make rope.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I can do cordage, no problem. And I also have my titanium wood burner.
Cool. Yay. And then repair kit and tools. So basically, number one thing for tool would be a knife.
Yes.
It's a survival situation. But...
Okay, I've got my knife.
And what do you got? What kind of knife is that?
This is my Mora. It was a gift from my husband.
My first Christmas
gift. I've only known him a month,
ever.
And it was my Christmas present, and I love it.
You looked at me
never
funny.
Never lost it. And something cool that you can do is, if you're ever worried about it falling out, just take a little hair scrunchie and wrap it around the handle clippy there and put it right over it, and you will never...
So it's only about $20 on Amazon you can get them. It was for 400 years made in Sweden, but now there's a company right here in Tukwila near Seattle. The Industrial Revolution bought Mora of Sweden knives, and so they're only about $20 for the clipper companion, and we get the stainless steel here in Western Washington because it's too wet to have high carbon steel.
Okay. Can I say one more thing about it? Just get orange, even though camo color and black, whatever, they look super cool. The second you set it down in the woods, gone. I've never lost this. Mm-hmm. It's been only 10 years. Can I show some other tools?
Sure.
Uh-oh. I'll have to get that later.
Yeah.
So you have to turn it off. Anyway. Yeah, so I carry rope.
Oh, yes, of course. And of course.
I like scissors as a tool just because. I carry gloves. Often I'll have leather gloves that I grab these.
Oh, yeah, leather glove if you're going to do anything with a fire.
Right, but I had these because I was doing some work in the woods. I also have my extra battery for my cell phone. And what y'all should always have, this one's kind of burly. This is my big whistle.
Yeah, whistle, of course.
it's a little different.
Emergency whistle. And by the way, if you are in any situations, you want to... Three means danger, emergency, or SOS. So three big whistles every 30 seconds or so, we recommend. All right, nutrition. Of course, you got as much food as you can have in there.
I had my lunch in it yesterday. Mm-hmm. I've got an extra two bars in it. Oh, bathroom kit, too.
Hydration.
Got my water bottle on this side. Do you want me to talk the Grail today?
Yeah, show the Grail.
So this is awesome, you guys and gals, y'all.
You don't. If you have this, you don't have to hoard water.
Right. So it's called Grail. It's Grail, and what it is it's this really cool. The company created a smaller version of this first. And then they've created this bigger version, so I get the bigger one because I like to have a little more water available. And it actually filters out viruses, a small amount of heavy metals, everything, actually.
And of course, bacteria.
Bacteria, all that. And so people actually take this thing with them down to rivers and things that you definitely
traveling
don't really want to drink
world.
Out of.
Mm-hmm, this is the one to get.
Yeah. And
there's a lot of water purification systems.
Even if you don't want to drink tap water someplace, if it tastes bad, you can use this. So all you do is you dip this part into whatever the water is, fill it up, and then you take this part, open the lid there, and this is the cartridge, and you just press it down in, and the water comes from through the filter cartridge up into this part, and it's totally filtered.
How many uses, if you're using, not super dirty water that plugs up the filter, how many?
I have to look it up on the Grail website. I feel like it was in the 300s. When it gets super hard to press down, then, you probably want to change the cartridge.
How much does a new cartridge cost,
A new cartridge on Amazon right now is about $30.
Okay.
But to give you this kind of safety, better than any other filter or purifier out there,
Yep.
It's worth it.
And Kim, you know, it would always say, and I'd be like, okay, cut the waterification part of the lecture short. But in this day of virus issues, one of the things that Kim always likes to cover in a lot of areas of the world is purifying water with having it sit out in the sun.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right? Can you explain
the UV
that?
Light.
Like in a glass jar? Or
yeah, how? So it has to be something that's clear, and you want the clearest water possible. Oh, dear.
Oh, so that the light can get all the way
through it. I think it's called the SODIS method, S-O-D-I-S, and you can Google it for the details. But the idea is, if you're living in a place that gets sun all day, I think that it just takes one day worth of sun. And so what people do is they put it in a plastic container and put it up on the roof, or just put it in full sun all day, and that's enough time for the sun's UV rays to kill anything that was living in there. And then there's rules as to, you know, if there's partial sun, how long you have to leave it out. But that's just one method that you can use. It's really cool.
And of course, number 10, emergency shelter. So we already talked about that. So
yeah. Bag. And then, you know, I carry iodine tabs too.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Gotta
have iodine.
Just because, even though I have that now, so I probably don't need to.
Yeah. A few ways to not get lost and not get an emergency is... we're going to move on from the 10 essentials.
But
what do you have?
I have the 11th essential.
That's right, the 11th essential.
So,
is it s'mores?
No, I wish, actually. No, they find that people who are in survival situations and for some reason they are managing to survive, they have the 11th essential, which is something to live for. And so I always carry an old picture of my last dog, Sky. I should probably carry one of Lily. But this was Sky, my search dog. And it reminds me of all of the amazing things in my life that I have to live for. In addition to that. So no matter what happens, I'm going to try my hardest to survive so I can come home to you.
Right.
My husband.
So in this time where we're replacing the term social distancing with physical distancing, but trying to have more social connections, that 11th essential is really critical for us every day to remember what to live for to get us through this time. So I think everybody should maybe meditate on it tonight and wake up in the morning, and I'm sure the answer will be there.
Yeah.
It's hard when you get depressed, because that's the definition of being depressed, is not feeling anything like that. So remember that. So it's nice to have an actual thing with you.
Oh yeah, you want something tangible with you if you can.
Yeah.
Can I say two other tools that I put in here just for fun?
Sure.
I put a tiny measuring tape, so when I'm out tracking wildlife, I can take some measurements, and I also have a hand lens, a 10 power hand lens, because I always find bugs or really cool things that I want to look at up close, and that's perfect. So those are fun things. They add weight, but for me, that's important.
All right, since we're getting on with time, I'm just going to go to my song. Tomorrow, I put in the notes that anything we didn't finish today, we'd finish tomorrow and do the cordage.
Oh, okay.
And so the making the rope. And so tomorrow we'll go over how to not get in trouble in the first place and loss proofing. And, I will. Let me see, push right there. In addition to that, I'm going to show everybody our screening form that they can use for when it is time to start having events, but still have to be careful. Keep that curve low so that the healthcare system doesn't get overloaded. And as well as our protocols for how to get people prepared to come and train them immediately, even before they come, and how to behave and have hygiene protocols so that events can start happening again as soon as possible. So I'm just going to go to my song, and this is by Chris Anderson, and I had to do this one today because I was, you know, feeling a little bit on the edge. And so this one is called The Meaning of Life. He wrote it when he was 15, I think he said. And I have to have my, do you think you can hold on to these?
Yeah.
And then I can... just hold it up there.
You go.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, so I can block this in.
And tell me where to put it. Right there.
Sure. And he's a Wolf Camp instructor, by the way, back in the day from 10, 15 years ago. And also, he became the top REI guide a couple of years ago, and runs programs with his wife, Megan, down in Arizona. All right, it goes like this. Have you ever seen the way the sun greets the day?
all on your face. Well, if you haven't, then here's what you should do. Take some time and look around you, 'cause this is real, this is life. It don't matter who you are, it don't matter if you're filthy rich or you live in your car. You know you can't spend every day along for the ride, 'cause these things are the meaning of life. Have you ever some time and look at people around you.